Oh, hi. My name is Yi Xin. I'm from the finance group. I just want to say that I feel this is harder than my job market because I'm competing against way stronger candidates. So today I'm going to show you a test which is going to tell us whether or not an investor has superior information about the idiosyncratic risks of the securities that he or she keeps in the portfolio. So the keywords here are idiosyncratic risks. Therefore, my test is going to detect the investor's stock picking abilities, but it is silent on the investor's potential ability to forecast aggregate risk factors. So I'm going to show you that the key methodology of my test is a comparison between the investor's return distribution and the return distribution of a counterfactual portfolio that picks stocks randomly. And I'm going to show you that in order to implement my test, we need to extend our benchmark from a time series of returns to a time series of return distributions. And in the empirical part of this project, we're going to apply this new test to the active mutual fund industry and identify a group of fund managers who are very skilled at picking stocks and are able to deliver very large out-of-sample alphas. So in general, it is very difficult to formally test whether or not an investor has superior information because information is just not observable. But the key insight from my paper is that even though information is not directly observable, we do observe what it is like to have no information. Specifically, I will try to remove any potential private stock level information that an investor might have by constructing counterfactual portfolios that pick stocks randomly. And then the detection of the investor's superior ability to pick stocks boils down to the comparison between the investor's return distribution and the return distribution of the counterfactual portfolio. And I'm going to show you that the stock picking skills of an investor is going to result in his return distribution to first order stochastically dominate the return distribution of the counterfactual random portfolio that has no stock level private information. And this first order stochastic dominance is the condition that we are going to test. So essentially, the new first order stochastic dominance condition imposes a strong requirement on the consistency of an investor's outperformance. So here's the spectrum of outperformance consistency. On the one end of this spectrum, we have the conventional positive alpha condition, whereas on the other end of this spectrum, we have the arbitrage condition. So positive alpha states that on average, this investor's performance should be better than the benchmark, whereas arbitrage states that the investor's performance should always be better than the benchmark. And our new first-order stochastic dominance condition sits in the middle of this spectrum. So first-order stochastic dominance states that this investor should have higher probability to realize high returns and a lower probability to realize low returns. Therefore, first-order stochastic dominance is weaker than arbitrage, but stronger than the conventional positive alpha condition. And since first-order stochastic dominance is such a strong statistical condition, it sets a very high bar for the investors. And that's why when we apply this test to the active mutual fund industry, we are able to identify a group of mutual fund managers who are very skilled and are able to deliver very large and appealing out-of-sample performances. So without further ado, let me just show you how to construct the test. So let's first stay in a single period. Say that Warren Buffett made 10% last month. So how do we know if 10% is good or bad? What we do now is to find the Buffett a benchmark. Let's say that the market is the perfect benchmark for Buffett, and the market returned 8%. So we figure that Warren Buffett outperformed the market by 2% last month. This is what we do now, but the limitation of this approach is that it does not tell us how likely this 2% single period outperformance is due to random chance. In other words, this investor could just be lucky last month. So what I want to do now is to run a statistical test on this single period fund outperformance so that we can figure out its statistical significance in addition to the magnitude. But the question is, how can we run a statistical test on a single observation? And it turns out this can be done using the following bootstrap procedure that has four steps. So the first step is to retrieve the holdings of this investor. So here's the example of Longleaf Partners by the end of 2012. And we have three columns here. So the first column contains the names of the stocks that the investors keeps in the portfolio, whereas the last column contains the portfolio weights. And the column in the middle contains the identity of the buckets that the stocks belong to. So now let me explain the buckets. So here, I'm dividing the universe of the stocks into 625 buckets according to the characteristics of the stocks. Therefore, the construction of the buckets captures the investor's exposure to systematic factors. Okay, now step number two is the critical step. So in this step, I'm going to create a replica of the portfolio. So here on the left-hand side, we have the original portfolio, whereas on the right-hand side, we have a replica. So the replica portfolio has the same weights as the original portfolio, and it invests stocks in the same buckets. But the difference between the replica portfolio and the original portfolio is that for each individual stock within the original portfolio, I'm going to replace it with another stock that's randomly chosen in the same bucket. And I do this for each individual stock and arrive at a random portfolio. So Bertha Melchior has a famous quote saying that a professional money manager cannot outperform a blindfolded monkey throwing dots on a newspaper. So essentially what I'm doing here is that I want to create my own replica of the fund, which has the same portfolio weight distributions, has the same characteristics, but I'm going to hire a monkey to pick stocks for me. And this monkey is going to give us a return. So now you can see where this is going. So step number three is to simply repeat this step. So I'm going to hire a bunch of monkeys. Each one of them is going to give us a return. So we'll end up with a return distribution. And the last step is just to compare the investor's actual performance to this counterfactual return distribution. So a few comments are in order. So first of all, there's a limitation in this approach. So by controlling for the characteristics, I can only measure stock picking skills in this exercise. So I have nothing to say about the investor's ability to choose characteristics. Fine. But what we gain from this exercise is that we now have the statistical significance of the investor's stock picking ability, even in a single period. So let me elaborate on this point. So let's think about what's going on here. So on the one hand, we have the investor's actual performance, whereas on the other hand, we have a return distribution coming from the null hypothesis of no stock picking skills. And then the comparison between the actual realization versus the null distribution constitutes a statistical test. And specifically, the ranking of the investor among the monkeys is just 1 minus the p-value of the statistical test on the investor's stock picking skills, even in a single period. So far, everything happens in a single period. But in the data for each investor, we also observe a time series. So the next question is that how are we supposed to leverage the repeated observations in the data to construct an even more powerful test? Now, let me ask you this. Suppose we now have an investor who's totally unskilled. Then how would his rankings compared to monkeys look like over time? Well, suppose we have a totally unskilled investor, then his rankings should follow a standard RID uniform distribution over time. Why? Because this investor is unskilled, so that he's no different from a monkey. Therefore, he has equal likelihood to show up at any part of the distribution. But here, we are looking for skilled stock pickers. Therefore, I require the ranking distribution of the investor to first order stochastically dominate the standard uniform distribution, which is equivalent to requiring the return distribution of this investor to first order stochastically dominate the return distribution of the counterfactual random portfolio. Now again, since first order stochastic dominance is such a strong condition, it has very nice properties compared to a positive alpha condition. So first of all, it's robust to heteroscedasticity. This is easy to understand because when I'm taking the rankings of this investor, I'm essentially adjusting for idiosyncratic volatility period by period. And another important property of first order stochastic dominance is that it develops robustness against benchmark misclassification. The reason is that the first order stochastic dominance is a requirement on the entire shape of the distribution. So suppose we have an investor who's truly skilled at picking stocks, then he should be able to shift the return distribution to the right without changing its shape. Therefore, stock picking is going to lead to first order stochastic dominance. But suppose we now have an investor who's also taking on uncontrolled risk factors, then he's going to change both the mean and the shape of the return distribution, thereby violating first order stochastic dominance. And that's a very nice property of this condition. So by applying this new test to the data, to the active mutual fund industry, I found that our new first order stochastic dominance test is able to identify a group of mutual fund managers who are very skilled at picking stocks and are able to deliver very large and consistent out of sample outperformances. And then with these managers identified, I'm able to make various findings on their characteristics that are also consistent with the view that these guys are indeed skilled at picking stocks. Now, to quickly summarize, there are two key ideas in this project. The first idea is to extend our benchmark from a time series of returns to a time series of return distributions so that now we can control for both the factor loadings and the degree of diversification of the investor. And the second idea is to impose first order stochastic dominance, which is a very strong condition. Therefore, we can develop robustness against problems such as hydroscedasticity or benchmark misspecification. So by applying this test to the active mutual fund industry, we are able to identify a group of managers who are very skilled at picking stocks. And then various findings on their characteristics can also provide us with new insights to better understand the mutual fund industry. Thank you very much.